I'd request if anybody is willing to please put on their cameras so I can see a few friendly faces. Otherwise, I'm just talking into a screen and it's difficult to know what's going on. Thank you, Otto, and thank you, Stefan. Appreciate your willingness to put on the camera. Nice to see everybody again after a couple of weeks. So we have about 10 people in class, and I hope some more will join. But here's our agenda for class today. First, I want to go over some administrative issue about the team assignments, which Luke has now done and posted on Moodle. Then I want to discuss a current event. Just yesterday, there was an investigative report on TV. There's a program called 60 Minutes on CBS in the US, and they did a story about Facebook, which is really quite concerning to me as a citizen and as a teacher of, and as a follower of these high-tech companies. The behaviors of Facebook have been revealed to be quite, I would say, disheartening. And so let's talk about that for a little bit. Then I want to go into the assigned material for today, which is the content of chapters 5 through 8, including looking at your homeworks, maybe clarifying concepts and refining them and providing some examples. So that's how I think we will try to occupy the next couple of hours. So before I begin, I want to ask you if you have any questions of an administrative nature. I can probably anticipate some of them, but I'd just like to know what are some things on your mind, and then I will get into the team assignments. And of course, you're always welcome to write things in the chat. I'm able to follow that. And if you'd like to use the mic, that would be fine too. So right now, I just want to know if there are any questions on your mind about anything in the course. Okay, so it doesn't look like there's any issues there. Let me go to the team assignments and share my screen. So just give me a thumbs up if you can see my screen in Moodle. Is it okay? Okay, thanks. So Luke published this on Moodle. It's under Introduction to the Case Method. We have 9 groups, right? About 5 people have been assigned to each group. So you should find your name within this group assignment. And then we've assigned the cases to the group. So, the Zoom video case will be a video presentation by groups 1, 2, and 3, and the rest of the groups will submit a 3-page memo. For the L'Oréal case, it will be groups 4, 5, and 6 that will do the video, and the other groups will do the 3-page memo. And then finally, group 7, 8, and 9, they'll do the video on Verily Life Sciences, and the rest will do a 3-page memo. So what it turns out is that every group will write 2 memos, and then they'll do 1 video presentation. Now, the content of both memos and the video are very similar. We'll get into more detail on that in our next webinar, but just to give you a flavor, since some of you will be, wanting to start preparation. First of all, you've got to make contact with all your team members, right? You can do that through Zoom, right? You can send each other messages through Zoom. If you like, you can request permission to have everybody's, email address or mobile numbers. That's up to you, how you want to keep in touch with each other within the team. Make sure that all of your team members do respond, because you know, if somebody is not responsive within a few days, we don't know whether they're still in the course or not. So you need to bring that to Luke's attention if somebody in the team is not responding to your messages. It may be possible that the team number may go down from 5 persons to 4 persons, for example. So we will have to request each team to find out who all are really within that team. And then, you know, in terms of content, there are 3 things that are to be covered either in the video or in the memo. The first is define the problem from the point of view of the key decision maker in the case, the protagonist. So once you identify the protagonist, then what are the problems that he or she faces, right? Define that. Then you need to analyze at least 2 alternatives or 2 alternative solutions to the problem. And by analysis, we mean pros and cons or strengths and weaknesses of each solution. And the 3rd section is recommendations, where you can either recommend one of the alternatives you have discussed or maybe some combination of them, and also give some guidance on implementation, what needs to be taken up in the short term, what needs to be taken up in the longer term. So that's the general content. The limit on the case memo is 3 pages, single spaced, and in 12 point font, right, with some reasonable margins like 2.5 centimeters. And then for the video, you have a choice what software you want to use. You know, Zoom itself has the capability to record the meeting, just like I'm recording this meeting. So you could all do that, or there's some more sophisticated video editing software available. I use something called Camtasia, but it's a paid product, and so I'm not sure if you have access to it, but I believe LUT has some video capture software, something with a P. I don't recall the exact name, but students have used it in the past. So that's a choice that you have to make. You know, the reason why we want to do this as a video instead of a memo is to give you practical skills in video making. You know, video is the new PowerPoint of business. You know, social media, on the web, right? PowerPoint is less engaging, and you know, video is more engaging. So try to exploit its capabilities and make it a persuasive video. So I'll pause there and then ask you again if you have any questions about the case team assignments. Have any of you been able to make contact with your team members, and is that going all right? You know, have you got positive responses from all your team members, or are you still waiting for a few to respond? There's still plenty of time. The first case Zoom is not due until October 22nd. So you have about 6 weeks, but you need to plan, right, ahead. Okay, I don't see any issues with the case teams or assignments, so we'll dispense with that. The next webinar in 2 weeks has a whole hour devoted to introduction to the case method. So if you haven't done cases before, don't worry. We'll go through the case methodology from first principles. But for now, just try to organize your teams and get in communication with each other. Okay, so now I want to talk about Facebook, which has been in the news quite a bit lately. I just want to ask, have any of you been following the news? What's the big issue now? That very latest, I saw it on TV Sunday night. And so I wanted to ask if any of you, I see a chat message from Caroline. Can we find all needed detailed instructions for the memo and video and the syllabus? There's a lot of, thank you, Caroline, for your question. There's a lot of detail on the memo, you know, in the syllabus. But for the video, it's very similar. As I said, the content of the video is similar. It's just restricted to 15 minutes of runtime. So within 15 minutes, you have to say in the video what the problem definition is, analyze the alternatives, solutions, and then make a recommendation. But yes, there is a lot of detail in terms of the role-playing scenario in the syllabus. Again, I'll just summarize it here. Think of yourselves in the team as staff members or a consultant to the key decision maker in the case. Okay, the person, the key decision maker in the case has come to you and told you that, you know, I know we have a problem, some issue that's not working for us. You know, there are some symptoms, but I don't really know what the problem is. So please take some time and investigate and tell me what the problem is and analyze some alternative solutions and tell me what I should do. So that's the role-playing scenario. You are either a team of consultants or an internal team of staff to the protagonist. And that person has asked you for help with the problem. So that's that. I hope that is helpful, Caroline, but you can read more details about the memo in the syllabus, and I will go over that again in the next webinar. Okay, any other issues or questions or concerns about the assignments? And keep it coming, even if it comes back later, I'll look at the chat. So now let's move on to Facebook. What have you been reading? Anything that caught your attention specifically about Facebook in the past couple of days? What's the issue that they are facing?
I am not sure if this is the issue, but I heard somewhere that they were planning some kind of a Instagram related app for kids below 13 years old, and now they have stopped that project because there is growing concern that Instagram is causing depression among youth.
Yes, thank you, Pankaj. That is correct. That news was a few days ago, maybe the previous week. So you know, in general, Facebook has been accused of targeting children, and especially with advertising and you know, all of those things. And legally, they are only supposed to address those who are above 13 years old, right? That's what their site claims, that if you're not 13, you're not supposed to join Facebook. And then they've come under criticism for a lot of different things, and targeting children has been one of them. So they had plans, like Pankaj said, to have a separate app, some lighter version of Instagram, which would be free of any offensive content, presumably, and that would be more with parental controls and things like that. and they wanted to launch that. That was on their roadmap. But because of the general criticism against Facebook for their predatory or aggressive, you know, targeting of children, they have publicly announced that they will withdraw that application. But continuing in that same line, there's been some even more drastic revelations about Facebook. So thank you, Pankaj, for starting the conversation. But let me ask if anybody else has any more updates after that. You know, what is the charge or the revelation? And I'm telling you, it's shocking, really. So that's why I've chosen to focus it on it this morning. It really made it difficult for me to sleep at night. Okay. So anybody else has any updates on what Facebook's been up to very recently? Okay, so I think that, you know, it's really something that's very recent. As I said, today is Monday morning and I just saw this on TV Sunday night. But here is the thing. There's been a whistleblower within Facebook, an employee, okay, who came on this program yesterday, CBS 60 Minutes, and she's revealed herself. You know, they shoot her with her complete, you know, they show her on camera, and they've named her. Frances Helgen is her name. She's a 37-year-old data scientist who left Facebook in May of this year, right? So just a few months ago, she left Facebook, and she has taken from Facebook more than 10,000 pages of internal documents, okay, which have now been released to the press. And she's a Harvard MBA. She's got a master's degree in computer science. She's worked for 15 years in Silicon Valley in Google and Facebook and other companies. So this is a seasoned veteran of the industry, and she has revealed. And by the way, she is protected by the Whistleblower Act. So there's a federal law in the US that if you can file any complaint against the Securities and Exchange Commission, which is a federal government agency, any employee can communicate anything with the SEC, including with internal documents from the company. So it's not like she cannot be charged for stealing trade secrets. Okay, this is a law that protects people from reporting on the unethical behavior of companies. And so this is what she has revealed. And I'm going to draw a diagram just to make sure that I get the essence of this. So please bear with me. I'm going to share a document camera. Right, so here's Facebook's advertising revenue, right? So this is the outcome, and this depends on engagement, user engagement. I guess this is not anything surprising. We all know, right? The more you like and discuss certain topics, the more Facebook's algorithm can target you. But here's the real revelation, is that who are the people who are more engaged? They are the people who are angry and have polarized views. So Facebook's internal data has revealed that the people who are more angry and have negative and polarized views, they are the people who engage more with the platform. And so who are these? These are the people who, a lot of them are those who, you know, they encourage hate and incite violence, right? So they have found these linkages in internal Facebook documents, which show that, you know, Facebook is actively targeting these people in order to make money, right? So I hope that part is clear. And to me, it was fairly shocking that this was known to Facebook, and they are discussing things like actively targeting these extremist groups to provide them with a platform for engagement. So on the face of it, you know, whenever they've been called to testify in Congress, Mark Zuckerberg and so on, they've always put on a public image that Facebook does everything it can to curb this kind of anger and violence and so on. You know, the groups that are having extremist views, they say that we actively search for them and we try to shut them down. But here, for the first time in internal documents, it has been shown that Facebook actually encourages and targets people with their algorithm who engage in this kind of antisocial behavior. So I just want to pause here and get your reactions to this. You can use the chat or you can use the microphone.
I think this is quite shocking and scary, to be honest. And there's the one documentary in Netflix, The Social Dilemma, where I think this subject was covered a little bit, but it was just like discussion about this, but not any evidence, I think, yet.
Yes, thank you, Sally, for your comment. And you know, I found it absolutely shocking as well, because, you know, it's an internal employee with 10,000 pages of internal emails and documents and research. They've even cited numbers, you know, what percentage of the users are in this category. So they are actually using variables to segment and target this subset of users who will contribute more to their revenues and profits.
Why they are doing this? Is this only about money? They are so greedy, or what is the reason for this, this kind of a behavior?
Yes, absolutely. That person who they interviewed said it's all about greed. And she said that, you know, Mark Zuckerberg did not start out this platform with that intent. You know, obviously they may have started it with a good intent to help people and be a medium for more conversation and social, positive social change. But it has grown so large, and you know, there's so many, you know, there's literally tens of thousands of employees, and the way the stock price and the emphasis on profit and growth, it comes down to particular levels where people are forced to focus on increasing revenue by these kind of methods. and they have known about it, but publicly they have said that we are doing everything we can to prevent it, and privately they have been doing just the opposite. So yes, Otto, it is about greed ultimately, unfortunately. And Petri says, naturally, the greed for money has taken over the good intentions. Yes. And you know, this is one case that has been revealed. But in general, many of us feel that these companies have grown so big and so large and so powerful that they are not a force for social good anymore, and therefore it is time for governments to step in and regulate them. You know, that is my personal view. And it's not only Facebook. If you take all these big companies, you know, Facebook, Apple, Netflix, Google, Amazon, right, these companies have become so powerful that they are able to go against not only laws but against basic values of democratic societies. And so they need to be curbed, otherwise we are going to be in deeper trouble. So this is one of the unfortunate sort of side effects of, you know, first you do good and then you get revenue, you get profits, you grow bigger. But when you get too big, then the power can be abused. And that's what we are seeing absolutely in the case of Facebook. And the same is a lot of complaints about Amazon mistreating its workers, right? The warehouse workers, they are always monitored by cameras. Their productivity is measured so much, they can't take proper breaks, right? So all this needs more government intervention. Otherwise, these institutions are not fulfilling their obligations to society. So again, I just wanted to bring this up in the larger context of corporate social responsibility, which has been a theme throughout this course. And I'm quite sure that Facebook will now face some kind of serious regulation. Earlier, they've got some slap on the wrist, you know, pay some fines, which is peanuts for a big company. But I think now they're going to require some structural organizational changes, maybe some government oversight, where they will have to increase their reporting requirements, make internal documents available, you know, be subject to audits and inspections more so than normal. Okay, I want to see if anybody has any other comments or questions about Facebook or any of the other companies that are as powerful as Facebook.
I was just thinking that because all these companies operate globally, and you mentioned that government should like really regulate all these companies. But the problem is, like, I think we need much bigger things than only the government itself. We need like something that will like be even over the government. Like because all these operate globally, and when people move, people go to different countries. So what do you see, like what could be a potential way, an institution that will regulate these kind of companies that work online and are everywhere in the world? Because we can see that in China they are really regulating these kind of platforms a lot. And that's why they have their own platform for example, for the Asian market.
Yeah, thank you, Caroline. I had some difficulty hearing all of the audio, but let me see if I've understood it correctly, your suggestion is that any one government may not be adequate to curb the power of these companies. So there must be some kind of international effort across countries and across governments to curb the power of these, right? So thank you for confirming that in the chat. I think conceptually that I absolutely agree with that. However, you know, in other areas of international cooperation, we've seen that it's been such a difficult challenge, right? You look at the response by the World Health Organization towards COVID, or you look at, you know, the United Nations trying to help to prevent war and famine and all of these things, and the efforts have not borne fruit, right? So again, I think that conceptually it is a good idea, but I don't see governments, you know, they are so they are themselves, they have their self-interest to preserve themselves, right? Every 4 years or every 6 years, there's an election, right? We just saw the majority party has changed in Germany over the weekend, right? We'll have to see who forms the government there. But, you know, as long as these are, you know, institutions that have such a strong self-interest or self-preservation on a national level, that's going to, you know, put a constraint on the international cooperation part. But I do encourage, I do appreciate your thought on, you know, if we can cooperate more in terms of international alliances, you know, across countries and governments. I do see some evidence of positive imitation. Like, I know for a long time, the European Union has been much more concerned about the power of these tech companies, and the US less so, because these are US companies and they contribute quite a bit in terms of the, you know, employment and economy of the country. So the US has always lagged behind the European Union in enforcement. But now we certainly learn from the experience of the European Union, and there will be some pressure from both Europe as well as domestically within the US for the government to take positive action against these companies. And let's hope we can move towards more international cooperation in this regard. So thank you. I appreciate your comment. Anybody else has any thoughts on what we can do to curb the power of these companies? All right, so then I will close out this particular topic, and then we need to move on to the content for today, which is about chapters 5 through 8. Chapter 5 is on partnerships and alliances. Chapter 6 is on marketing research. Chapter 7 is on consumer behavior. And chapter 8 is on technology and product management. You've done the readings, you've watched the videos, you've done the homework. So I wanted to give you a chance to raise any topics for further discussion. What was it that you found particularly interesting? What was it that you might have found a little bit confusing? Were there any tools, concepts, frameworks that you would like some further discussion on? That's the topic we are on right now. You can either write in the chat or you can use your microphone. Let's move on to some discussion on theory. look through your notes or, you know, any materials that you have accessible to you and tell me. Let's take alliances and partnerships first. Anything you would like to discuss in that particular chapter, chapter 5? So while you are thinking about it, let me go to some of the homework people have posted and ask you to consider that as a basis for the discussion. I'm going to share my screen again. So here's a answer to what customer lifetime value is. I want to you to read this and then tell me whether you think you agree with it or not. So first, I would like to ask a clarification question. I'm not quite familiar with what a bonus card is. Can somebody explain, please, what the reference is in the second line to the A part about a bonus card? Customer having a bonus card for a long period of time?
I think that that's actually a loyalty card.
Okay. Is it from a store?
Yeah, I think so. I think that some stores here call them like bonus cards, even though they're essentially like loyalty cards.
Okay, thank you. So I guess I'll throw open this. My question was that is it clear from this answer what a customer lifetime value is? And in B, they say that it's hard to define, but is it really hard to define? I mean, it may be hard to measure, but is it hard to define? How would anybody of you, how would you give a better succinct definition of what customer lifetime value is?
I would probably say that it's about how much money a customer brings into a company, and it can be essentially like high or low, like during the entire lifetime of the customer, like buy something from the company.
Right. Thank you, Maria. Very succinctly, it's about the total profit that a customer can bring to a company over their lifetime. When you say money, it can mean either revenue or profit, but the technical term customer lifetime value, it's the discounted value of all future profit from the customer. So when we talk about customer lifetime value, it is about profit. So I think that it's fairly simple to define. Now, it's not easy to measure, which is why things like bonus cards might help, right? If you have a loyalty card or you have a membership program like Amazon Prime, Amazon can clearly know, if it's selling something to me. I've been a member of Amazon since about 1995. So I'm sure somewhere in the records, they have some estimate of how much I've contributed to them, right? So it is difficult to measure, but it can be done. And so next question is, what is the importance of customer lifetime value? Why do companies like to measure it? Why do companies like to track it? What's the practical benefit of measuring this for a company? Any thoughts?
I would say that would then tell the company how to distribute their, for instance, marketing expenses. So they would emphasize and invest more in the customers that bring in more profit than the ones that don't bring in that much profit.
Okay, very good. So if it's for existing customers, then you can certainly target them more in the future. You can try to cross-sell them other products, or you can upgrade them to newer versions of the products, right? So there's a huge value to allocating marketing effort, absolutely. And the better companies do it. Whenever you call some company for customer service, it's happened to me in the US sometimes when I want to cancel, say, my cable service, right, or my some telephone service or a credit card service, they always try, if they can see in their records that what is the estimate of customer lifetime value, they are given guidelines on how to prevent you from discontinuing, right? So they make you all kinds of offers, like, we'll waive the next year's membership fees for you if you stay with us. So Maria, you have given one important practical aspect of this, that you want to be able to target your higher CLV customers with better services and products and better marketing so that they contribute more to you in the future. However, there is also the possibility to use this concept for targeting new customers at acquisition. Petri says it helps you to create marketing goals, the long term and the short term. Petri, could you please amplify a little bit? What do you mean by that? Are you talking about existing customers' goals or acquiring new customers?
Well, basically, I mean that when you measure the customer lifetime value, you will know that when you have measured it, who are the loyal members, etc., etc., then it helps you to notice how much of those people are the, I use the wrong word right now, the heavy users, the engaged users. And then you can notice that for example, 15% of the customers are not loyal or member, so you can change your marketing in some kind of way to target those guys much more to create more customer lifetime value. It's very hard for me to explain what I mean, but
no, I understand. I understand. Yeah. So you're talking about existing customers.
Yeah.
Yeah, good. So that's similar to what Maria was saying. My point is that it can also be used, you know, to target new customers. And this may seem counterintuitive because you need some history before you can compute the CLV, right? But here's the thing. If you can analyze the characteristics of your existing customers with high CLV, if you can measure their demographics and their lifestyles and attitudes, then you can use those accessible characteristics to target new customers as well, right? So it's not just limited to improving the existing customers or getting them to buy more, but it can also be used to target new customers. And we didn't have time to in this course to get into it, but if you were to do a separate course on customer relationship management, there are also some formulas for estimating the CLV of a typical customer in a new segment. Okay, so to put it very simply, if you have the annual profit contribution per customer and you can multiply that by the number of years that they will be with you, then you can get there an estimate, a numerical estimate of the customer lifetime value, right? I'm putting it very simplistically. There are other more sophisticated formula that can be used, but by studying existing customers, you know, if you can find other customers who are like them in certain respects, then those people, you can actually target them for their customer lifetime value. So that increases the importance of the concept. Certainly, it's useful for improving existing customer relationships, but it can also be used for segmentation and targeting of new customer segments. That's one point I wanted to make.
Can I also add something here?
Yes, please. Possible?
Yeah, in the same sense of thought, in one of the companies that I used to work with before, we used that the metrics, the customer lifetime value, to practically estimate how much do we need to invest for acquiring the new customer. So, right. For example, let's say we are targeting a specific type of customers, and we know that these customers will bring, let's say, 10,000 euro in their lifetime or whatever is set in the company, then, you know, okay, it makes sense to invest 1,000 euro per customer to attract them. And then if you see that this metric is going over, then you know something is wrong. Then you probably don't target the right person, or you need to redefine something like, well, exactly what you practically described in the targeting manner, like characteristics.
Thank you, Stefan. And that's an excellent example that it has implications for the acquisition costs and how much you're willing to spend. Because, you know, if you only look at the CLV numbers without considering the acquisition cost, you could be going over the limit, and therefore it might turn out to be counterproductive. So thank you for sharing that. That's a great comment. Okay. Now I want to go to another topic, which is, you know, it's also been written about in the homework. What's the difference between a business partnership and a strategic alliance? You know, very often these two terms are used equivalently, especially in the media. They talk about alliances and partnerships as if they are the same. But I like to draw some distinction between them And I wonder if you have picked that up in any of the readings or the video. What's the difference between a business partnership and a strategic alliance, if any? Because we don't need two different terms if it means the same thing. Any thoughts? Some of you wrote about these concepts, right? Any thoughts? What's a business partnership or a strategic alliance? Maybe I'll get you to read what has been posted about this. So this is something somebody wrote about: business partnerships, agreements made between two or more firms to work towards mutual goals. Partnership established through legal procedures. Then it says a partnership can be project oriented, meaning that the contract is made for a specific period of time or when a goal has been reached. Business partnerships differ from corporations in a way that no individual entity is established during the procedure. The most common types of business partnerships are general partnership, and limited liability partnerships. So do you agree with this? Anybody would like to refine this at all? Is there any confusion here between a business partnership and a legal partnership? So I do think there's some confusion here. These two are different concepts altogether. A legal partnership is a legal form of organization, right? There's a very clear terminology that you can have a business registered as a proprietorship, that means sole ownership, or a partnership, or a private limited company, or a public company, limited company. These are legal forms of registration and organization, right? For example, a lot of lawyers firms and accounting firms, they are legal partnerships where the liability is shared by the founders or the partners. Okay. But that's very different from the way we've been using business partnerships in terms of this chapter and this material. You know, you could be a public company and still form business partnerships, or you could be a sole proprietorship and also form a business partnership. So do you see the difference? I think whoever wrote this answer has confused the two concepts. A legal partnership as an organizational entity is different from an agreement to cooperate on some project. So I see some confusion there. Okay. Would you agree, or do you see it any way different? I just want to get a sense. Are we on the same page?
Yes, I think there are different types of legal entities that you can form, and that's different from business partnerships that are undertaken, for example, to improve the efficiency of your supply chain or improve the accessibility to human resources, etc. So where there might be some legal agreement that is drawn, but there is no specific taxable entity that gets formed. Yes. Sometimes they create these special purpose vehicles which might be a legal entity, but it's mostly like a temporary arrangement but there maybe it's kind of a hybrid area, I imagine, in that case.
Yes, thank you, Pankaj. There is a legal contract in a business partnership. You know, there's some agreement. You do this, I'll do that. It's an agreement for cooperation, right? But any legal organization can do it, whether it's a partnership or a proprietorship or a private company or a public company. So it is a tool for business cooperation. That's the way I put it. But it's quite different. It doesn't matter what the legal registered organization is, which practices that. Okay, very good. So if we are clear with that, then the discussion has to move to how is a business partnership different from a strategic alliance? Or is there no difference? Then do we need two different terms for that? Any thoughts? Guesses?
Well, I understood it that way, that in a strategic alliance, there are two entities that are working together, but they are separate entities. And in the other, there are kind of one entity.
So there is some confusion there, Anna. Thank you for your comment. I think, first of all, a strategic alliance usually is two, but there may be more companies involved, right? You can have a strategic alliance with three companies involved, for example. But even in a business partnership, there are two or more entities. You know, the cooperation may be between a supplier and a customer, or between a manufacturer and a distributor. So I wouldn't say that is a distinguishing characteristic. There are multiple entities involved in both partnerships as well as in strategic alliances. What might be a more fundamental difference, if any?
I would probably focus on the interests of the entities that are involved. So in a business partnership, that would be more of a mutual interest, what they want to accomplish, whereas in a strategic alliance, that like might be that if they work together, they might accomplish their own separate interests, that they don't necessarily have to be aligned completely, as they more likely would be in a business partnership.
Okay. So there is some difference in terms of the stakes involved. You know, the business partnership has perhaps lower stakes in terms of the consequences than a strategic alliance. You know, a strategic alliance is a bigger deal. And the way I would clarify it, Maria, is that in a strategic alliance, the agreements are for a specific initiative, but it does require alignment of strategy and vision and goals. Of course, there are goals of the whole alliance and there are individual goals, and both have to be aligned with one another. And even in a business partnership, there is some goal for the whole partnership as well as for the individuals. But the basic difference is that a business partnership is ongoing. It's for you know, open-ended cooperation. You need each other on a long-term basis, whereas a strategic alliance is for a specific initiative. You know, that's what makes it strategic and different, is that it's a big deal. We need to do a plan together. See, you can have a business partnership between a client and an advertising agency, where sure, there is some agreement, some purchase contract which governs the relationship, but it's ongoing, you know, year after year, unless there's some reason to change it. That's an ongoing business partnership. Whereas a strategic alliance is for a bigger deal. My best example would be the alliances we've seen in terms of the COVID vaccines. There's Pfizer and there's BioNTech. BioNTech is the startup which had the mRNA technology. Pfizer has the resources to get the approvals in different countries and then do the marketing and distribution. So they have a specific agreement for doing, you know, co-development and co-marketing, and there must be a specific time horizon in mind that these agreements will expire on a certain date, and then they can go their separate ways. So that's how I like to think about it. And if I could just share again my document camera with you. So take a look at this. I distinguish between three types of relationships between companies. One is arm's length on the left. These are like one-time transactions. You're buying something from somebody and you're probably not going to continue with them. At the other extreme is a strategic alliance, which is so specific. It's for a particular, you know, a very important final goal in mind, that once we've developed this vaccine and we've done it for we share the profits on a 50-50 basis for 3 years, then we will share the intellectual property and go our separate ways. And the business partnership is in between, which is that yes, we have to cooperate with each other, but it's ongoing and it's something that's part of our business operations. It's not as big a deal as the strategic alliance. So I see this as a continuum going from left to right in terms of the stakes involved, the amount of planning that's needed, and even the amount of legal contracts and structured agreements have to increase as you go from left to right. In the business partnership, they're pretty standard business contracts. But in a strategic alliance, you have to outline in great detail what are the responsibilities of each company, what are they going to invest, how will the profits be shared, and once the thing ends, then how is the intellectual property going to be shared. So that's, you know, that's the way I look at it, and I think that's what the media sometimes writes about them in one way, you know, alliances and partnerships, but I do see a difference. Strategic alliance requires joint strategic planning. There are teams on both sides which engage in coming up with a specific document that will govern the future activities of this particular alliance. So I'll pause there and see if that makes sense to you or not. And this has management applications as well. For example, business partnerships can be managed at a lower level, and it can be delegated. You know, one person in each company can be responsible for, say, the relationship between the advertising agency and the client. Whereas for strategic alliance, you have to allocate a team of people to go through that planning process. And indeed, it involves a lot of issues, including, you know, strategic fit, as well as, you know, the cultural fit and all of these things. A strategic alliance is an alternative to a merger or an acquisition, which is largely irreversible, right? But mergers and acquisitions give you a high amount of control. Strategic alliance is one step short of that. It has the intent of being as big a deal as doing some kind of, you know, you want more control through the structured strategic alliance agreement, but you also have the flexibility to exit if things don't work out, which would be extremely difficult in a merger or an acquisition. So a strategic alliance is a particular type of agreement which has some inherent flexibility. If things don't work out, you can still go your separate ways. Okay, so now let me throw it open to other topics. Maybe you guys have, you know, there's been a lot of chapters, 5, 6, 7, and 8. We've just touched on chapter 5, but there's other chapters. Chapter 6 is on marketing research. Anybody would like to raise any topics for discussion with regard to marketing research, or chapter 7, consumer behavior, or chapter 8, which is on technology and product management?
Just to mention that in the customer lifetime value, Caroline had mentioned a point in the chat. I think you missed that point.
Sorry. Here it is. It is a good metric to size up customer satisfaction, loyalty, and the visibility of a brand. Is the company's current strategy really working or not? Well, you have the customer lifetime value, and you must have some benchmark to compare it against, right? Whether it's working or not, because it's in an individual level estimate per customer. You could aggregate it to a segment, and maybe you had some marketing goals or objectives for the whole segment for profit for the year, and then if you're not meeting that, then certainly there is some diagnostic possibility to fine-tune the marketing strategy or the programs. So yes, I think that it can be a good tool for that. I don't know if it's directly a tool of customer satisfaction right away, or you would need to drill down a little bit more and then try to do some marketing research to find that out, because the metric is numerical. You might be able to track it and see whether it's going down, and then in that case it prompts you as a marketer to find out the root cause of the problem. Why is CLV declining? And then you might get some indication of the customer loyalty, but it would require some follow-up marketing research. But thank you, Caroline, and thank you, Pankaj, for alerting me that I missed this chat. I would like to address all of the comments in the chat. But let's go to some more topics if we can in the other chapters. Anybody has any comments or thoughts? What would you like to discuss? Okay, I'm going to proceed to chapter 7 on consumer behavior. And here's something somebody posted on this categorization of early adopter. So let's read this. Early adopters are those who use the new technology or any products recently introduced in the marketplace before anyone else does. They often collect various information materials about new products and become leaders in certain fields. My question is, do you agree with this definition? Or can it be refined a little bit? Does this definition recognize any difference between innovators and early adopters, or does it equate the two? It says that early adopters are those who use the new technology or any product before anyone else does. Is that correct?
I think the early adopters, they, it's not like they don't use it like before that everybody else does, but more like they're the first that they're willing to use the product. So
then Stefan, who are the innovators then?
I don't know how to connect those two right now.
So I think there's confusion that this person has made them two the same. Whereas in practice, we know the framework tells us that innovators are the first and early adopters are the second. Okay. And there are numbers to go with this. Innovators are only 2.5% of the population, generally speaking, and early adopters are about 13.5%. It's very common confusion to merge the two. However, there is an important difference. It's in terms of risk aversion. You know, the innovators are more risk seeking than the early adopters. That's why the early adopters wait a little bit. The early adopters will take word of mouth references from the innovators. The innovators actually like to take on problems with the products in their first version. They like the excitement of debugging the product and bringing those bugs to the attention of the seller. So they want to be kind of product developers themselves in a small way. Whereas the early adopters, they want to wait a little bit. They don't have the interest or the resources to debug the product to the same extent that the innovators do. So we must remember that the framework has very distinct categories, and innovators and early adopters are not the same. That's what I wish to bring to your attention. Any reactions? Do you agree with that, or would you like to take issue? For the same reason, innovators are probably less price sensitive than the early adopters. Innovators are happy to pay high prices, but early adopters would like to wait till the price comes down and the product is a little more stable.
Is there a more specific distinction in terms of stages of product development that could be associated with innovators and early adopters? So by product development, so you have, there is a design, then there is the prototype, then there is the, say, the first MVP, and then the first functional version. Maybe it's easier to take some example. I'm trying to think of some example. Maybe electric vehicles is one. So I imagine now in the next one decade, we are going to have multiple different kinds of designs or for electric vehicles. So could you perhaps elaborate a bit? How would you say, like, who would be the innovators and who would be the early adopters?
Yeah, so that's great. It's a very good question. First of all, we have to specify the boundaries of the product life cycle, right? So whenever we see any adopter curve like the one in chapter 7, it's always post-launch. So this is about consumer adoption in a commercial sense. So it is after the product development process that is internal to the company. I would say it applies to MVP, the minimum viable product. You've launched that, you've launched that with full pricing and marketing support. That's when the innovators come into play. Anything prior to that, whether it's prototype testing or alpha testing or beta testing, or even a test market, is not a full commercial launch. Okay, so that's one distinction I would like to make, is that the innovators are the first commercial customers of the product. But again, in your example, the EVs has undergone so many different metamorphoses over the years. So we have to specify what is the product we are talking about. For example, I remember the first EV1 from General Motors in the 1990s, early 1990s. I have ridden in those. You know, that was General Motors' immense contribution, but there was a huge range limitation, and it was, you know, only launched for about 3 years, and then GM withdrew all those EVs from the marketplace, and it actually dumped them in a landfill, which was the subject of a documentary with a lot of negative criticism. So that was kind of one stage of EVs. Then we heard nothing about EVs for a while, and then you started hearing more about the Tesla Roadster, right? Tesla Roadster was a sports car, which, you know, cost $100,000. So that would be another life cycle. And then we come to more of the mass market. You know, I would say for the four-door sedan at a $40,000 price point. So first you have to define what is the product category that you're talking about. And indeed, there may be different generations of EVs. So we have to fix that. And then we have to define the innovators, early adopters, and so on, after we have fixed what is the product category. So I cannot answer the question for over 10 years, who are the innovators and early adopters, but I can say that there was a different category of innovators, adopters for the Roadster, and then there's a different category of EV adopters now for a $40,000 fully electric EV with a range of about 200 miles or, you know, 300 kilometers. So Pankaj, that's how I would try to answer your question, that, you know, it's a managerial tool. It's how you want to use it. Nobody outside can tell you what the category is or who the innovators are. It's It's whatever the managers decide in terms of when the launch date is, when is the MVP launched, the minimum viable product. And I would say take that as the starting point. When the first commercial minimum viable product is launched, then you measure the innovators as the first 2.5% of the market that adopts your product. After that will come the early adopters, the early majority, late majority, and the laggards. That's how this tool is to be used. Does that make sense?
Thank you. Yeah, that makes a lot of sense. It's very clarifying. If I could just kind of ask one more thing. So from the marketing point of view, if you are launching a new product, then would it be that your initial marketing campaign is specially targeted at the innovator mindset or the early adopter mindset? And is that also something that is a point of consideration?
Absolutely. That's exactly the point of the theory, is that the innovators require a different kind of marketing strategy. For example, everything has to be customized to the innovators. They are paying high prices. They are the ones who are taking the risk. They will ask you for certain, you know, customizations in the early stages, right? Now, when you go to the early adopters, your marketing strategy has to shift a little. Your product has to be more stable. The prices have to come down. It has to begin showing some practical benefits. Then, and you have to reduce the amount of customization because you want the price to come down. So you have just shifted your marketing strategy for the early adopters from what it was for the innovators. And then there's a whole different marketing strategy shift when you want to cross the chasm and go to the mainstream. So absolutely, you've hit the nail on the head. The only purpose of this framework is to imply that the marketing strategy has to shift in time as you target, you know, new segments of consumers. Each of these is a different segment with different needs and different concerns. And the marketeer's ability to be able to move move their strategy through those different segments is what will get them success in the marketplace.
Thank you. That is very clarifying. Thank you.
So we are on the topic of consumer behavior. Let's see if you have any more topics that you would like to discuss. Otherwise, I will go to another post in the homework and see if we can clarify some things. So let's read what Stefan has posted about design thinking since he's here in the class. Let's read this. Design thinking is a concept that focuses on user-oriented approach for developing a product or service where multi-background teams are focusing on identifying innovative solutions to problems by looking through the eyes of the users. So Stefan, I agree with this. I just wanted to follow up and ask, what is the nature of the multi-background team? Can we specify that a little more? What do you think is the, who are the people who are involved in this multi-background team? That would be a nice refinement of this answer.
Yeah, with that I meant, let's say, multiple teams, let's say marketing, come together with IT, with other departments which are crucial about developing the product, and they share information and kind of about the customer, about the technology, and align it into a product. This is what I meant.
Yes, thank you for that. That's correct. But instead of looking at it as functional areas like marketing or IT, I would say that there are three important components to any design thinking team. One are the technologists or the engineers who know what what the feasibility is of pushing various technological solutions. Then we must have people from the business end, right? All the marketing folks, the IT folks, they have to make sure that there is enough revenue to cover the costs and keep the business model running. And the third are the people who are concerned with the ease of use and the human factors, right? Whether it's good to look at, whether it's comfortable to use, whether it's easy to navigate, right? So the three generic groups in any design thinking team must include the technologists, the business people, and then the human factors people. That is what makes it multidisciplinary. Of course, if you go into the business model, and you can also add to that by saying there must be all the different functions like the IT people and the marketing people and the customer service people and all of those. But the big picture is these three groups of skills and knowledge bases that we need in order to make a good design. Okay, let's go to some more concepts here. And please keep putting things in the chat if you want to discuss any specific issues that you found interesting. Otherwise, I'll just go over some of these homework items. So let's read about what a tornado is, and then we can come back to a specific question. A tornado is a transformative period of the marketplace which pursues when a substantial share of buyers adopt a new technology or solution. The tornado is a result of customer behavior. First, customers choose a market winner, and this new technology becomes a must-have requirement for all the rest of the consumers. Once a market leader is chosen, buyers expect them to set standards for the rest of the market. Inside the tornadoes, customers are focusing from whom they must buy the new solution, as the product is not anymore just a nice have thing. It's important for a marketeer to know the concept, as today almost all industries rely on technology, which is why all companies must learn to thrive inside the tornado. As there will be one market leader in tornadoes, the winner is gaining the most with the biggest market share. So as a marketeer, it is important to be as agile as possible with the strategy and be aware of the new competition or a new emerging leader. Okay, so I think most of this is on target. My question for all of you is, are competitors necessary, or are competitors always present in a tornado? Can a tornado exist without competitors is my question. Any thoughts? This answer seems to imply that there are always competitors in a tornado, and you know, the winner must provide a better solution in the competitors than the competitors. My question to you is that, can there be a situation where there is a tornado without serious competitors? Any thoughts? It really speaks to what's your understanding of what the tornado is. Yeah, you know, that Caroline raises a good question. I'm asking whether a tornado might exist even in a monopoly situation. What is the essence of the phenomenon? What happens in a tornado?
It seems the tornado is more likely to exist in a monopoly situation. One of the reasons being, like, we are talking about a major shift in consumer behavior, and that at the back end, that implies that there is some kind of a fundamental new innovation. And if that is the case, it is unlikely that there are multiple players. But that's, I am kind of extrapolating here, so I'm not sure.
Okay. So again, let me throw it open to everybody. What's your understanding of the phenomenon tornado? What really is happening when there is a tornado? A company has crossed the chasm, right? The tornado happens after crossing the chasm. So what is the reason for the tornado? I think people must know this answer. Don't feel shy. Just write it in the chat or speak up. No, nobody wants to volunteer. Okay, so let's clarify. The tornado is an explosive growth in consumer demand. Okay, the need and the benefit have been established by crossing the chasm. So people know they need the product. But the reason why there is a tornado is that your own ability to satisfy the demand, there is some constraint on it. It's an operational bottleneck. Okay. The reason is that you've grown so fast. I mean, the customer base is growing so fast that the company or the seller is not able to keep up with capacity, either capacity in a manufacturing sense or capacity in an operational sense, where, for example, you don't have enough servers, and you know, when the consumer is clicking on your website, all you see are spinning wheels, right? You're not able to access the service. Or if there's not enough distribution, the customers want the product but it's not available. So do you see that the essence of a tornado is supply side constraint. And so really it has nothing to do with competition. Competition may or may not exist. You know, if the competition has seen the spurt in growth and they decide to enter the market, then you will have competition. But it is completely possible for a company to offer its service and face that sudden explosion in demand, irrespective of whether there's competition. You know, whenever we have those hit products that are in shortage, you know, like the Nintendo Wii or some of the more recent products, you know, you'll be doing the Zoom video case. The demand for Zoom, you know, during the pandemic early months just exploded, and they're not able to keep up with it easily. So that's the essence of what the tornado is. So, you know, I think any company, whether it's a monopoly or not, needs to address the tornado. Just because you're a monopoly, you cannot lie back and say that, oh, take it or leave it, this is what it is. Because unless you scale up, the customers may drop out altogether, right? So I do think whether you're a monopolist or not, this phenomenon is very important. But competitors are not necessary for the understanding of the concept or, you know, for its application. Individual companies need to cross the tornado, whether there is competition or not, is the point I want to make. Is that something that you agree with? So again, we have many concepts here, you know, and there is some good understanding. Most of you have written correct answers for the concepts that were assigned, but there are some things there that need to be, you know, refined. And this is especially important as you get into your case memos and your video on the case. You know, you have to all have, you have to have a common understanding of what the basic concepts are and apply them appropriately to the case. If your understanding is not the same among the team members, please clarify that before you submit the memo or the video, because otherwise there'll be confusion. And, you know, if you don't use the concepts and the theories appropriately, you know, that will not make an effective written memo or a presentation. So that's why it's important, you know, to understand and apply these concepts. So again, let me see if you have other concepts that you would like to have some discussion on or clarify. Anybody who feels they wrote something which they were not so sure about, if you would like me to read and comment on your particular answer, I'm happy to do that. Let me go to another answer that's been posted in the homework. This one is about minority equity investment. Let's read that and see if we agree or maybe can be refined in some way. Minority equity investment is a term used when investment is made towards a business but does not hold that majority stake ownership or does not give full control over the business decisions. For example, if an investor or a partner holds less than 50% of the company's shares, they are usually minority equity in shareholders. That's technically correct. I agree with that. The second part is, even though minority stakeholders don't have complete control over business decision making, they are still important part of the organization and have some influence over the business. It is important for a marketeer to understand the owner structure and who can impact the decision process. That's also correct. I agree with that. Let's go to the example. My previous job experience has taught me that in order for two companies to do business together, the first step is to find the right people in the company who are able to make decisions regarding their business processes. So this is where I see a disconnect between the answer and the question. The question was to give an example of a company that might have done a minority equity investment. So the C part doesn't really give us an example. So now my question to you is, in terms of application, what is the practical use of a minority equity investment? And can you give me an example of a real company that might have used this particular investment opportunity? So this is a discussion item for everybody. Can you tell me when is a minority equity investment used, for what purpose? And then is there an example that you can give? So the A and B parts of this particular answer are correct, but I just want to get at the C part, the application.
I think one example that was mentioned earlier was, I think one of the big automotive companies has also invested in Tesla in a minority investment. I do not remember which company it was, but so for them, it is a minority. I think it was some battery manufacturer or something, but Panasonic, I think, was it Panasonic? That would be possible example of a minority equity investment, which is a strategic investment in another company.
Yes. Thank you, Pankaj. Panasonic and Tesla, they have a major strategic alliance agreement for battery production and sharing of the gigabit factory in Reno, Nevada. So it's a very complicated alliance, but there is no, as far as I know, there wasn't any equity sharing, there was only cost sharing. But the example that I think you are pointing to is that Toyota very early on took a investment of about $50 million in Tesla, where Toyota wanted to have the battery know-how from Tesla. Okay, so it was more of that kind of a relationship. And certainly the RAV4, the RAV4 EV from Toyota used the technology, the Tesla batteries early on. So that's a good example of a minority equity investment. I have a response from Otto. Minority equity investment is used like when company do investment in a startup company. Yes. So this is the thing. It is used mainly to support strategic alliances. It's a bigger deal than a business partnership. A business partnership is a contractual arrangement. If one company is taking an equity investment in the other, then it's much more strategic and long term. It's actually a safeguard against opportunism. Opportunism is a term where a more powerful company might act and exploit the less powerful company. So in this example that we gave, you know, why did Toyota need to take an equity investment in Tesla? It didn't really. It could just have had a contract that we'll buy batteries from Tesla, right? You make it as a production contract and we'll award you the contract. But when Toyota signals to Tesla that we'll invest some money in you, first of all, it's trying to influence them. So quite often, if you take a equity position of 10% or more, then you might be given a board seat, a seat on the board of directors where policy and strategies are discussed. So certainly you can have access early to the plans of the partner, and you can also try to influence them. But more important than that, Toyota is signaling to Tesla that we will not harm you in any way. You know, one of the biggest kind of risks in any strategic alliance is who owns the intellectual property. And one partner could reverse engineer and offer a competitive product to the other partners. That's fairly common. But when Toyota is investing $50 million in equity in Tesla, it's a signal of a safeguard. You know, Toyota is telling Tesla, we will not exploit you or harm you in any way, because if we do, we will be devaluing the value of our own stock investment. So minority equity investments are usually made by the more powerful partner in the less powerful partner as a signal of commitment and as a safeguard against opportunism in the future. That's the real practical use of a minority equity investment. So I agree with Otto and also with Pankaj, and it's a pretty widespread tool. And guess what? If you start with a minority equity investment, you know, and things go well according to achieving the objectives of the alliance, then the amount of the equity investment could increase over time, and ultimately it could lead to a future merger or acquisition if it is mutually beneficial. So again, a minority equity investment is also kind of like a experiment or a test to see if things will work out. And if things go well between the strategic alliance partners, the equity position might increase over time and lead to an eventual merger or acquisition. So it's a very useful tool, minority equity investment. It has multifaceted applications. Any comments or reactions? Okay. Any other concepts you would like me to get into? Okay, Pankaj has asked about complexity. Is it fully addressed if customer learning curve is taken care of? Okay, so let's talk about complexity. It's one of the six characteristics that help to facilitate adoption. Relative advantage is the most important. Compatibility is the second. And the third is complexity in order of importance, right? Very simply, complexity says that if the product is complex to use, then the adoption is going to be slower. So complexity has a negative relationship with adoption. Complexity is also the opposite of ease of use. So another way, you know, inverse of complexity is ease of use. Ease of use is positively related to adoption. So when we talk about, you know, complexity as ease of use, then certainly learning is a part of it, right? So if you want to improve complexity at the design stage, you have to make sure that your product is easy to learn as well as it should be easy to use. You know, certainly the learning can be addressed if you have training or you provide good manuals and video tutorials and so on. But in spite of that, even if the customer learns, it might require an elaborate set of protocols to do the setup and use the product. You know, if it's just inherently complex to start up the system every time, you know, consider an automated chemical control process in a factory, a continuous process control, right? It's not easy to shut it off and then restart it. There are, so even if the users are well trained and they learned about the process, it is still complex to use it every time you want to start it up again from scratch, right? Go to the example of the EV. You know, you might know how to charge it, but every time you charge it, it's going to take a long time. So in that sense, it is complex. So I wouldn't equate complexity to the difficulty of learning. It's a component of it, but it's not the whole story. There is the complexity has two parts. One is the learning and the other is just the setup and the use, even if you've learned how to do it. And so I think both have to be addressed at the design stage. You know, the learning can be addressed through training and tutorials and manuals, but the design of the product itself must lend itself to every time using it easily and conveniently. That's my response, Pankaj. I hope that makes sense. Okay, very good. I want to encourage if anybody else has any concepts that they would like to clarify, concepts, tools, frameworks, theories on any of these chapters 5 through 8. Nobody asked anything about technology management or product management. Is there anything you're curious about in terms of chapter 8, technology and product management? We have 6 minutes before our time runs out. So again, I want to offer this opportunity if anybody has any issues that they would like to bring up about chapters 5 through 8, then this would be a good time to do that. No, nobody has any more questions. Going once, going twice. Okay, since nobody has any more issues to discuss and neither do I, then we'll just close out here for the day. You all have a good night. And I will see you back here in a couple of weeks. Please start organizing your teams to tackle the case assignments. Thank you and have a good night. Bye-bye.
Actually, I have still one administrative question.
Yes, please.
So at least like last time that we had the seminar, we already had got grades for the homework assignment 1, but at least I haven't got the grade for the homework assignment 2.
Okay.
So is it maybe just running late or?
Yeah. I have read them and I have put them down on paper, but I've failed to post them on Moodle. Thank you for reminding me. I shall do that right away after this, after okay. this webinar. Thank you, Maria, for reminding me about that.
Yeah. No problem. Thank you.
Okay, then I'll see you in about 2 weeks. Bye-bye.